Hi everybody, this is Dr. A, and I'm bringing you a short video on capillary collections, so skin punctures, dermal punctures, however you want to call it. Okay, so why would you want to do a capillary collection? So sometimes a venipuncture is not possible or advisable. It could be done in the instance for burn patients, patients that are at high risk for DVT, that's deep vein thrombosis, so it's clotting issues, and venipuncture can make that worse. If they are at risk for anemia from excessive blood draws and you want to limit the amount of blood that's drawn, or if they have bleeding issues where a phlebotomy stick would just keep bleeding and bleeding and bleeding, whereas a skin puncture could heal up faster. The capillary collections or skin punctures is the preferred method for getting blood samples for routine testing of newborns. So if you need to do a neonatal bilirubin, a newborn screening, point of care glucose or hemoglobin, a CBC or an ABO and RH testing, there are other tests that can be ordered. There are also generally preferred for children younger than 2 years, and skin punctures are also used extensively for at-home glucose testing and point of care testing for glucose in many healthcare facilities. Those are your just accurate glucose that you can do at bedside, in hospitals, clinics, nursing homes, you know, wherever. So what are the differences between venous and capillary blood? So first, you need to note that some tests cannot be done via capillary punctures, and those are tests for blood cultures and all coagulation testing. So the first difference between venous and capillary is the source of the sample. It's in the name. So venous blood comes from the veins, and then capillary comes from the capillary bed, and the capillary bed is a mix of venous and arterial blood. Also, when we do capillary testing, for example, for whole blood glucose, for glucose monitoring, it's whole blood versus serum or plasma. So there are some differences there in the type with the testing that's being done. The difference number two, or the second difference, is if the site is pre-warmed, this is often recommended for capillary punctures, then there will be more arterial blood in the capillary bed and thus more arterial blood in the capillary sample. If you need to do repeated testing for any analyte, it's best if you have the same collection method to make the results comparable. So a glucose by a capillary puncture will be about 10% lower than a serum or plasma glucose that's drawn at the same time. So you need to keep that in mind if you're comparing results, if one was drawn capillary and the other venous. So let's talk about the different skin puncture devices. So automatic puncture devices will deliver a swift puncture to a predetermined depth. And that is set by the manufacturer, and it can be seen on the boxes very clearly labeled as to what depth these devices will attain. The blade has to be retractable. That's an OSHA requirement, so it has to go back up into the collection device, and it cannot be reactivated. Some devices are contact activated, meaning when you press them against the skin, they will activate, and others have a trigger that has to be activated by the phlebotomist. The one here has a trigger right here. You have to press on this part to activate it. Lancet devices puncture the skin, so create a little puncture hole. So they tend to create smaller drops. They are good for repeated testing, such as the at-home glucose monitoring. Incision devices, they slice the skin. They are preferred for the collection of samples that require more than one drop. They heal better than the punctures and faster also. Next, we're going to talk about the microsample containers. So the micro collection tubes are made of plastic, and they're available with a variety of anticoagulants and additives. They can be used for testing on large analyzers in the lab with some modification. Those modifications usually require you to take the plasma or the serum from the microsample tube and put it into some kind of sample adapter for that machine. If you're testing whole blood, then there's usually some kind of manual feature for a CBC machine where it can suck the sample straight from that little micro collection tube. The micro collection tubes here are portrayed here. I have a handful. I don't have all of them, but these are the ones that we have in our little phlebotomy lab. So they come in a variety of sizes and designs. They all have a way to get the blood into the sample, whether it's a little scoop or a little capillary tube, and they have a lid. And there's usually some additives in there or not. It just depends. The capillary tubes are also available. They're portrayed here. They are plastic and they come in a range of sizes. The plain ones have a blue band across the top. And then you have some that are heparin coated, and so there will either be red, yellow, or green band across the top of the tube. And these could be used for capillary blood gases, and it can be used in other capillary collections. One of the ones you can use these when you do a newborn screening to fill in the circles also. And I will talk about newborn screenings in another video. Some additional supplies you might want to consider are warming devices to increase circulation. If you, there aren't any in your facility, you can just use a washcloth with warm water. So nice warm water. You don't want anything that exceeds 42 degrees Celsius, and you want to apply it for 3 to 5 minutes. There are some commercial warming packs that are also available. Maybe the nursery might have some. Some are one use and done, and I have also found some that are reusable. They're kind of neat. They're a gel with a little metal piece in the middle, and when you activate the metal piece, it starts warming. It stays warm for a while, and it becomes solid as it warms, but you can actually reuse it. So the way you reset it is you take the whole thing, get some boiling water, and you drop it in boiling water. You turn the heat off after it and let it sit in boiling water for several minutes. And that puts the liquid, the chemical, whatever's in there, back to liquid. And you pull it out without reactivating, without moving or bending the metal disc in it. I let it cool off and back to room temperature, and it's reusable, so that's pretty neat. Plus the boiling can sterilize it. But anyway, so those are some supplies you might want to consider having. Next, we're going to talk about the site selection. So capillary collections should be performed on warm, healthy skin that's free of scars, cuts, bruises, and rashes. Bone punctures can occur if you select the wrong site or if you use a device that punctures too deep for the site that you have selected. The problem with bone punctures is it can lead to osteochondritis, which is a painful inflammation of the bone or cartilage, or osteomyelitis, which is a potentially serious, sometimes fatal bone infection. So we do not want to create bone infections, especially not in our little bitty newborns and our babies and little children less than two. The puncture depth and width. So to minimize this risk of inflammation and infection, the lancet should never ever penetrate more than 3 millimeters. So I've given you here a ruler. Just, you know, there, I'm sure with a video it's probably not the scale. It depends where you're watching the video, etc. But we have inches on one side and centimeters on the other, and this one is 1 centimeter, and so 3 millimeters is only 3 of these little lines, okay? So 1 centimeter is 10 millimeter, and so this little square represents 3 millimeter as to the scale of this ruler, and so you would never want to go more than that, and that's just the absolute maximum depth. For a heel puncture, the maximum depth is 2 millimeter for a little baby, so that's 2/3 of that, it's even less, right? And that's because the calcaneus or the heel bone can lie very close to the surface. And the width of the puncture, or if you have an incision device that slices, should not exceed 2.4 millimeters. So again, all of that is less than 3 millimeters, so smaller than the square that's represented here at the scale of, you know, this being 1 centimeter or 10 millimeters. So for the site selection, for adults or older children, it is best to use the palmar surface of the hand and to use the third or fourth finger, so the middle finger or the ring finger. The puncture should be made perpendicular to the ridges of, in the fingerprints as portrayed here, and that's so that it lessens the flow of blood into the grooves. It keeps it from channeling into the finger tip grooves here. For infants, so that would be 0 to 1 years of age, the dermal puncture is performed on the heel, and you only want the medial and lateral borders of the plantar, which is the bottom surface of the heel, can be used. So bottom of the foot, both little sides of the heel. You have to avoid the back of the heel or the sole of the foot. So these indicated here. So one of the rules, and this can depend from child to child, is generally if they have started walking pretty good on their own, then they've gotten about too old to do a heel stick collection. So you know, that's another rough guideline because, you know, children progress differently. So these steps are, we're going to go over all of them in now and in detail. So you want to review the requisitions, make any appropriate notes on it, such as indicating that you are collecting a capillary sample. You want to sanitize your hands, put on gloves, assemble all the equipment that you need after you reviewed the requisition. You want to clean, select the site and then clean it. You want to position and hold the area that you're going to stick, so that could be finger or the heel. Make the puncture, dispose of the blade, prepare to collect the sample, and then collect the sample and then complete the procedure. So let's do them in detail. So you want to review the requisition for the test order to make sure that you get everything that is needed and that a capillary collection, if you want to do a capillary collection, is indeed appropriate. And then you want to document under requisition that you are performing capillary collection so that this can be noted on the results in case there's anything that comes into question. You want to sanitize your hands and put on gloves. You want to assemble your equipment, so in that you will be selecting the appropriate device, whether you're doing heel stick, finger stick, or whatever. And you are going to also grab, you know, the microcapillary tubes or everything that you need. You're going to select a site, and you do want to warm the area first if necessary. So if you're trying to do a finger stick and your hands are really cold, it is very advantageous to warm it because it's going to be really hard for it to bleed if the hands are cold. Then you're going to clean the site using 70% isopropyl alcohol and then let the site dry completely. Again, alcohol can, it can hemolyze blood, it will cause the puncture to sting more and hurt the child. So that alone should be reason enough to let it dry. Also, when you clean something with alcohol, whether you're doing alcohol pad or you're doing alcohol-based hand sanitizers on your hand, it is not clean until it's completely dry. So you want to let it dry completely. Then you're going to position and hold the area. So you want to hold the finger or the heel firmly. For finger sticks, you want to put the patient's palm up and then hold the finger. And for the heel sticks, you want to hold the heel by placing your thumb in the arch and wrap your hand over the top of the foot and place your index finger behind the heel. So I have it demonstrated here on one of those little squishy fake feet here, baby foot. So then you're going to make the puncture and you're going to dispose of the blade properly. That means usually in a sharps container. You do want to align the device so that the cut is made across the fingerprint ridges or the heel lines. And then you want to dispose of the used blade immediately in that appropriate container. So you're going to prepare to collect the sample next. So you want to wipe away the first drop of blood with a clean gauze pad to prevent contaminating the sample with the tissue fluid that got released from the puncture. You want to keep the finger in a downward position, right, to help encourage blood flow, ideally below the heart. So not like what I'm showing here because that's above my heart, but below the heart, so that will allow better blood flow. For heel sticks on babies, depending on the crib design, the ones that are in the plastic bucket looking cribs, usually you can tilt it up and prop their head up so that then the heel is below their heart and that will help bleeding to be more free. So once the blood is flowing freely, you're going to position the container for collection. To get the blood flowing, you can alternate applying and releasing firm pressure proximal to the site to increase blood flow. And so that's on, you know, closer to the body is proximal. So if you're squeezing a finger, you'd go in from the hand side. Going from the hand side and kind of squeezing up. But you don't want to press too hard. You don't want to massage it constantly or milk it because that can cut off flow. It can cause hemolysis and it can introduce tissue fluid back into the sample. You want to avoid scraping the finger or the heel with a collection container, especially if they have these little scoop devices. If you open this one up, you'll see it has a scoop design on it also. And as you get the blood in it, you want to tap that micro collection container here on the counter or something lightly to get the blood to move to the bottom and to mix if there's anticoagulant, so it starts mixing with it. So be careful not to overfill any micro collection tube that contains anticoagulant, otherwise the ratio is going to be off and you have a risk that it will clot. The order of draw for capillary collections is completely different than the order of draw for your regular venous punctures. It's almost completely backwards from it, right? So first you want to collect platelet counts, complete blood counts, or any other hematology test in a purple-pink top. It's supposed to be purple, but they often look really pinkish. So there's usually something similar to this color right here. And then you would follow with the chemistry tests that are in a heparinized tube, which would be green, so another anticoagulant. And then you can follow that with the serum tubes. So the bilirubin, it's usually a brown tube that protects it from light with a yellow top, or it could be just a plain red top. And then last steps, you want to complete the procedure by applying pressure to the puncture site using a clean gauze square until it stops bleeding. For infants, it's good to hold the foot above the heart to help stop the bleeding. Once the bleeding has stopped, you can bandage the site for older children and adults, but bandages are a choking hazard for children less than 2 years. Then you want to label the microsample container and place it in a larger holder for transport to the library. And that is it. All right, thank you so much for your attention. I will see you in the next video.